So as a host team, we can go ahead and start passing around the baskets. Want to remind you, we have Easter cards in the back. They're invitations, so if you want to take some, you can spread the word. We really want all of you to be here and just invite as many people. We'd love to see everyone out here. We'll go ahead and pray for us, and then we'll have a promotional video up on the screen. If y'all just stay seated. Dear Lord, just want to thank you for allowing us to be here today, dear Lord. Just allowing us to be in the security of this building with all the family that we have here, dear Lord. Pray as we go throughout our week. We just think about this Easter Sunday coming up that, you know, we realize the impact it really had on us. And Jesus died on the cross and was risen all for our sins, dear Lord. And I just pray that as we go throughout the week, we just realize how significant that is and that just as good news at noon does, we can bless other people and show them the love that Jesus showed us, dear Lord. In your name pray. Amen.
One man. One life, one mission, one Savior. One cross, two thieves, 3 days, 4 days. Life, meaning, purpose, driven. Death, beaten, found, free. Sunday, one purpose, one message. Jesus changes everything.
Well, good morning, City Church. How are you? Are you excited for Easter? Man. I've been going through the Gospel of Matthew this week and just kind of looking at Jesus' ministry and his life and thinking about what next Sunday is all about. And I'm excited. I don't know about you, but I'm pumped. I'm praying for God to do big things. We're actually next week also going to have some guest missionaries from Thailand that are going to be with us. So they're going to be selling some things to support their ministry. So share that with you to be aware, to be ready to give to them. And then also just, I want to just echo what Adam shared about how amazing it was to go and serve at Good News at Noon. And I met with their pastor, Jeff Bagwell, last week. We had breakfast. And I'm encouraged when pastors are about the big C church, not the little C church. And I'm encouraged when pastors don't care about who's getting credit, who's getting glory, who's doing what. They just want to serve and see Jesus get glorified. So I was encouraged about that. Pray for their church. They're praying for our church. And speaking of prayer, let's pray before we go into the sermon this morning. God, I thank you for who you are. And Lord, as we just enter into this week leading into Easter, God, Father, it's weighty. It's weighty as we were reminded of the price Jesus had to pay for our sins. And God, this morning, Lord, as we kind of conclude this series and our focus on hurdles and choices and, Lord, where are you in the midst of bad decisions that we make or other people make that affect us? God, I pray that we would just be alert to what you're doing. God, I pray for those that may be here this morning that aren't really sure about you, God, aren't really sure about church or whatever that may be. God, I just think you're a good father. And at the end of the day, that trumps a building, it trumps a group of people, it trumps what we think church is all about in this country. So, Father, speak to us this morning, God. Get me out of the way. I ask for this in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you have a Bible or an app or whatever, you can go to Matthew 26. We're going to be in Matthew 26, a little Matthew 27, and then Acts chapter 2 primarily today. And as you turn there, just to briefly recap the series, if you've missed some of the weeks or you haven't gone online to watch them. Well, first week, we've talked about this idea of hurdles. And the idea that our choices are like setting the GPS for your life. You can look at where you are right now, and your choices were what got you made this turn or stay on this road. It was all about choices. We looked at the woman at the well who had been married 5 times. She was on boyfriend, sugar daddy number 6. But we're going to look at it. And how an encounter with Jesus changed her. And we realized first week that with God, our setbacks are just setups for our comebacks. Last week, we talked about when other people or other situations put hurdles in our lives. We didn't ask for it. It just happened. We looked at the story of Joseph and his going from seeing God give him this vision to his brothers casting him a lot, selling him to slavery. Potiphar's wife all the stuff that went on, and how at the end of the day, it's okay to be frustrated, but frustrations have to be coupled with forgiveness. Frustrations have to be coupled with forgiveness. So this week we talk about what's next. Whether you've made a choice that's put a hurdle in your life, or other people have made choices that have put hurdles in your life, what's next? At the end of the day, what's next? In going into Holy Week and knowing Good Friday and Easter Sunday's on the horizon, I'm reminded of two primary characters that during the arrest and trial of Jesus, and even the crucifixion, Peter and Judas. Right? If you've been in church for a while, you know, you've heard of Peter, you've heard of Judas. And I want to look at these two guys, what was going on during the arrest and the pre-arrest of Jesus and everything that was going on. So Matthew 26. And I want to encourage you this morning, whether you believe the Bible or not, whether you're checking church out or not, whatever, that's fine. Put yourself in these guys' shoes. Okay? Just put yourself in these two guys' shoes and imagine what they're going through emotionally. Imagine what they're going through mentally. Imagine what they're going through spiritually. Just put yourself in their shoes. Matthew 26, verse 30. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." And Peter answered them, "Though they all fall away because of you, I will never fall away." And Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this very night before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times." And Peter said to him, "Even if I must die with you, I will not deny you." And all the disciples did the same. So imagine this. Jesus is pretty much telling his boys, "Look, dude, y'all are all about to scatter. Y'all are all about to abandon me." And then Peter, who was always the guy stepping himself up to be put in awkward situations, right? Like, "I'm going to be the one to try and walk on water." Didn't work out for him so well. You know, Peter's always putting his foot in his mouth. And so Peter says, "Though they all fall away," like he tries to trump the other disciples, "though they'll all fall away, I will never fall away." And then Jesus just looks right back at him and says, "This very night, not tomorrow, this very night, you'll do it three times. You'll do it three times." Now imagine being Peter. How does that feel? Like, you just, like, went to bat for Jesus. And Jesus said, "No, dude, you're going to fail me even worse. Like, no one else is going to deny me three times, but you will." I mean, I just feel the weight of that statement. And I think about how often do people try to tell us that we're about to make bad choices and we don't listen? How many times do people try to speak life and to say, like, "Hey, you might not want to do that. That's probably not a good idea." They said, "No, man, it's going to be fine. It's going to be fine." I remember I was sitting at Chick-fil-A with a friend of mine, and he was telling me about being in this situation with this girl he was dating, and their relationship had started off all wrong. They had gotten physical, they had gotten sexual, and they were just making bad decisions, bad mistakes. And so the girl, another guy, contacted the girl, was trying to date her, pursue her, and do things the right way. And so he kind of freaked out a little bit. And he's like, "But Drew, I don't want to lose her, you know, blah, blah, blah." I said, "Bro, think about this, man." I said, "You're about to be in prime dating season. Something about the fall, things get romantic. Right? Something about the fall. There's cookouts and bonfires and, you know, holidays and family. Something about the fall, it gets romantic." I said, "Bro, you're about to be stuck." I said, "You get her back, even though I don't approve of this, because you just started off wrong. I don't think God's in this. God can redeem it, but God's not in it right now." I said, "You're about to be stuck." He's like, "No, dude." I said, "I'll tell you what, bro. If you don't," and then some things had happened, so just flash forward. So we had that conversation. Same stuff's going on again. He calls the drill messed up. And I said, "Bro, listen. If you don't break up in the next 24 hours, I guarantee you'll be with her for at least the next 24 days. A prophetic moment. Okay?" And sure enough, that 24 hours goes by. "No, man, I think things can get better. I think things can get better." I said, "All right, man, you know, Thanksgiving's only 12 days away. And then Christmas, and then, oh, New Year's Eve, man, you got to have a girl on New Year's Eve, right? You know? And then, man, Valentine's Day is right around the corner. You're about to be stuck." And sure enough, old Andrew's not as dumb as he looks. And he gets, progression happens. And it ends up just getting to a place where that another guy again pursues her, the relationship's toxic, and she leaves him. And it was one of those things like, I didn't have to tell him that I told him. He knew it. That's a good feeling. Can we just be real for a minute? Yeah. He was like, man, you don't have to tell him. I told you so. But man, I think back to Peter and Jesus is saying this, and you know, I wonder if when everything's said and done with Peter, is just what he's processing in his mind. What he's processing in his mind. So often we have people tell us, hey, this is going to happen. It's not going to go as planned. You're going to mess up. You're going to fail. No, we're good. No, we're good. You know, maybe it's with a job. You know, maybe it's something financial. Like, hey, told you shouldn't spend all your money on scratch-offs. You know, like maybe it's one of those things, told you should have been saving. And then it all comes into fruition. Matthew 26 now. This is where it really gets weighty for Peter. Jesus has been arrested. Jesus has been betrayed. We're going to go back to that in a minute. Matthew 26, verse 69. Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. Okay, so Jesus has been arrested. Peter's sitting outside in the courtyard. And a servant girl came up to him and said, you also were with Jesus the Galilean. But he denied it before them all, saying, I do not know what you mean. When he went out to the entrance, another servant girl saw him. And she said to the bystanders, this man was with Jesus of Nazareth. And again he denied it with an oath. I do not know this man. After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, certainly you two are one of them, for your accent betrays you. Then he began to invoke a curse on himself and to swear, I do not know the man. And immediately the rooster crowed. And Peter remembered the saying of Jesus, before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. And he went out and he wept bitterly. A couple things to point out here. What's very interesting to me. Peter was one of the older of the disciples. And it tells us twice, a little servant girl accused Peter. I just kind of see this from like an outsider standpoint and kind of laugh a little bit. Like here's Peter, you know, talking so big to Jesus. And then it's not like guys with swords were coming to him or guys with weapons were coming to him. It was a little girl. A little girl. And Peter denies it. And then another little girl denies it. Peter's walking wounded. But what's really weighty about this is when it talks about in the last part of this passage, verse 75, after the rooster crowed, it says, Peter went out and wept bitterly. Wept bitterly. In the Greek, it talks about that being similar to those of people who are mourning. And I was trying to think, you know, mourning is something hopefully none of us have experienced a lot of. You know, I was thinking, when was a time in my life when I really mourned? And I remember being in high school, and my grandma her cancer came back, and didn't know it was as bad as it was till my parents took us over there to see her, and seeing her laying in bed, barely moved, could barely talk. I remember I just going in the next room, and I just was mourned. I just wept. It was mournful. And I just remember the pain and the angst and just this tension with God. Like, why is this happening? But here's the thing about that. I didn't cause that to happen. Peter caused what he was going through to happen. That makes it even weightier when he's having to mourn for his own hurdle he put in his life that he's got to now get over. And now he has to get over. And it made me just think of this question. Have you ever done something that's made a loved one or someone you care about mourn? Over a choice you made, over a hurdle you put in your life. I mean, that's what Peter was feeling. That's what was on his heart. That's what was having him to shed his own tears. And, you know, we have to think about Peter. I mean, Peter, his intentions were okay. I mean, he was trying to follow Jesus, but maybe you can relate to Peter in this sense where he was a little overeager, right? Have you ever been that or know someone like that? A little overeager, a little too gung-ho. He was a little overeager, he was a little underprepared, too. He was a little underprepared. In the midst of all that, you know, Peter just had to have the biggest hurdle in front of him was just this feeling of failure. Just this utmost feeling of failure. Let's look at Judas now. Matthew 26 still. Verse 14, 15, and 16. I want you to see the comparison of the heart condition of these two different characters. Verse 14, Matthew 26. Then one of the 12, whose name was Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said, "What will you give me if I deliver him over to you?" Him being Jesus. And they paid him 30 pieces of silver. And from that moment, he sought an opportunity to betray him. So often we don't think about this, but Judas made a selfish choice that ended up affecting so many people. Right? I mean, it was God's will all along for Jesus to be crucified. Go back and read Isaiah 53 if you need to. But if you just put yourself in a modern, you know, the modern sense and put yourself in a setting, if Judas doesn't do this, Jesus isn't betrayed. And in their minds, they're thinking, if Judas hasn't done this, Jesus lives. Right? Like they're thinking, in this moment, Jesus isn't crucified if Judas doesn't do this. Mary doesn't see her son murdered. The disciples don't lose their Lord and friend. It's a game changer. One man's choice affected so many people just in that setting. And ultimately, his choice is used for God's glory. If you've read the book, you know the story. But it's amazing to think about it. In that context, Judas made a selfish choice that put a giant hurdle over other people. But what's interesting is to go to Matthew 27 now. We'll start with verse 3. And again, you think Judas here, just a few days before, sold out, ready to sell out Jesus. And now, verse 3, Matthew 27. Then when Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he changed his mind. He changed his mind and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders, saying, "I've sinned by betraying innocent blood." And they said, "What is it to us? See to it yourself." In throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed and went and hanged himself. He went and hung himself. But the chief priest, taking the pieces of silver, said, "It is not lawful to put this money back into the treasury since it's blood money." So they took counsel and bought with them the potter's field as a burial place for strangers. Therefore, that field has been called Field of Blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken by the prophet Jeremiah, saying, "They took the 30 pieces of silver and the price of him on whom a price had been set by some of the sons of Israel, and they gave them for the potter's field as the Lord directed." God wasn't surprised by Judas's choice. It had been spoken a long time ago by the prophet Jeremiah. But this is something very interesting to me that the Lord was showing me this morning about Judas. Judas did something that the Bible tells us to do. He repented. He changed his mind. That's what in the Greek it's talking about. When he changed his mind, that's where we get this word from repent, to redirect. Judas redirected. And you think of also, oftentimes the word repent is this idea of running away from. You know, when I was a small group leader for high school boys, I said, this is what you do when you get a bastard direction with a girl. You run away. You run, okay? You do like Joseph and Potiphar's wife. You run, okay? But when you think about that same correlation with repentance, if you're walking into sin, you turn and you make a run from it. But it's not just enough to run from it. It's about who you run to, right? It's not about just the turning and running from, but it's who are you running to. This was the difference between Peter and Judas. Judas repented, but he didn't run to God. He ran to his guilt. He saw the hurdle of what he had done as the period at the end of the sentence, not a comma. And that was what the game changer was for him. See, Peter put a hurdle in front of his life, but was able to overcome. Maybe you're here this morning, you've got to realize, man, whether you've made choices or other people have made choices, it's one thing to repent, it's another thing to forgive. But you've got to know who you're running and focusing back on. So many times we want to get in this place where we're working out our own salvation with just ourselves. You know, I'm trying to be a better person. I need to read more. I need to post some more spiritual stuff on Facebook. I'm trying to cuss less, smoke less, drink less. And all those things aren't bad. But it just sounds like it's a lot of work. It sounds like the focus is a lot on what you're doing or not doing instead of what God has done. And see, the idea is without Jesus, it's the idea of running and not knowing where you're going. It's like running in the dark. I remember one time my buddy and I, we were driving down to the town where I went to college, and there's this like 23 miles of road where you have no cell phone signal, and there's no place to stop, and there's no street lights, it's just old highway. And he had his foot up, kind of weird, driving, and at one point I caught a cramp, and he brought his leg down. When he did, he hit the light switch on the car, so the lights went out. And you know what it's like if you ever go into the complete dark, your eyes don't adjust fast enough. So all you see is darkness. And I remember being so scared because it's like, all right, when the lights are going to come back on, there's going to be like a 14-point bug, and it's game over. And it's not like we're going to be able to call anybody. You know, AAA will never find us. You know, this is it. And I think so often times that moment of fear, that moment of I don't know, I have no control, I'm anxious. So often, that's us if we're completely redirected the wrong way. If all we're trying to do is work to be good enough, work to be better, repent but not know who we're running to, it's that same feeling, darkness. It's just darkness. So maybe this morning you can relate to this hurdle conundrum of choices being made, either by you or by other people, that have put something in your life that you've got to get over. Or maybe not. But for a moment, let's just shift the focus off of us for a second. And let's look back at Acts chapter 2 now. Acts chapter 2 is where we see what was next for Peter. We see what happened with Peter. We see what happened with Judas. We know what was next for Judas. Ultimate defeat, hanging himself. But we're left wondering what was next for Peter. And we see in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit coming into the play finally. And we see that Peter stands up on the day of Pentecost and delivers probably the most bomb sermon anyone had ever heard outside anything Jesus had ever said. And 3,000 just recorded men give their lives to Christ, probably closer to 5 with women and children. And see, the idea though in this whole thing was Peter's faith was focused on God, not his failure. Peter's faith was focused on God, not his failure. That's what made the shift. That was what got him over the hurdle. And see, I don't know if you're like me, but I've been hurt by people in religious societies before. I don't know if you're like me, but I've had Christians put hurdles in front of me before. I don't know if you're like me, but unfortunately, I as a Christian have put hurdles in other people's lives. So what's next? What's next? Psalm 118 says this. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. The psalmist isn't saying not to trust in man. It's saying what's better than trusting man. It's to take refuge in the Lord. I have a graphic I want to throw up here for you. I saw this week preparing. Not relevant at this point. Yeah, the other one. The graphic. If not, it's fine. You can take it down, silly. Okay, so, yeah. Don't trust me, but follow me on social media. Psalm 118 talks about don't put your trust in a church. It's okay to trust a church, but don't put all your trust in a church. Don't put all your trust in a pastor. But you think, like, what do you mean? Don't do it. There's no perfect pastor. No perfect church. No perfect small group. No perfect campus ministry. It just doesn't exist. And so often we see how often the church has failed us. I mean, if you watch the news, a huge scandal just came to light in one of the biggest churches in our city. The church failed. And many people are angry, and they have a right to be angry. Many people are left confused, and they have a right to be confused. And what's scary is many people will leave that church. And of those many of those people will probably stay out of church. Perhaps some of those people, that was their last breaking point. Or they can never forgive a church. I don't know if you're hearing what I'm saying this morning, but at the end of the day, this is what it comes down to. You've got to forget idolizing the church. It's all about Jesus. That's the whole thing for Easter Sunday. Here's a spoiler. Jesus changes everything. Period. Jesus changes everything. And despite a church failing, or despite a pastor failing, we've got to go to God with those things. I read that story yesterday morning, and it made me sick to my stomach. The idea of a scout leader and a deacon of a church raping a child. It made me sick. But then I was moved to the hurt this now grown man has been carrying for years. How unhealthy and sick spiritually this deacon has been for years. And I just began to pray, God, restore and redeem. Restore and redeem. What's happened has put a hurdle on this person's life, many people's lives. God doesn't get glory when revenge is taken. God gets glory when people are forgiven and redeemed. God didn't get glory in Judas killing himself. God got glory in Peter knowing what was next and crossing over that hurdle and getting on with his life. And you just really have to ask yourself at the end of the day, are we sold out? If being hurt by the church causes you to lose faith in God, your faith was equal. That got checked me this week, church, just to be honest with you. I look back at all these negative connotations I've had at churches in the past. What did I expect? Right? What did I expect? So this morning, as we get ready to kind of conclude, this is my question. If you claim to be a Christian, are you really sold out to what it's about? Maybe you got into things a little like Peter did, a little over eager, a little underprepared. And you've had some setbacks, or you've got a bad taste in your mouth because of church. That's okay. Or maybe you're here this morning and think, man, I've got all this crap I've got to clean up before I can really, let people know I'm a Christian. It's like, man, join the club. I mean, seriously, if you talk to anyone who's honest, that's everyone's story, man. We get one thing cleaned up, and then, oh, man, I gotta work on this now, too, and I work on this a little bit more, and, man, it's just a process. It's just a process. I really think God takes great delight, not so much in the giant leaps, but in the steady steps. The steady steps. Just being consistent. Because at the end of the day, how you are doesn't define who you are. How you are doesn't define who you are. So this morning, I just want to invite us to a time of prayer. And honestly, ask the question, what's next? What's next for my life? What's next in my faith journey? What's next in the process of maybe forgiving or being forgiven? What's next in trying to figure out what this whole being a Christian thing looks like? What's next when it comes to being a part of a church? This is what I love about City Church. We've got good music. Preaching's okay. But man, we've got good people who are just honest about doing life. And that encourages me. Not that anyone's made it. We don't have any super saints, Awanas, all Americans. Okay? I'm kind of glad. And I'm not going to ever pretend to be the smartest person of the Bible nerd, but I just enjoy the fact that we can do this journey together. And we can slowly but surely see Jesus starting to win people, win souls, and win back our city. And it's fascinating to me because I hear this all the time. Church is boring. Christians are boring. Sorry, dude, you just met some boring churches and some boring Christians, man. I mean, I love being a Christian. I can remember the fun things I'm doing, praise God. You don't get that all the time. You have your service. The fun times I get as a Christian don't go on my record. That's a popular thing. And it's things that matter. It's things that matter. I just crack up when I hear people talk about the good old days. The good old days. I'm back in high school. Who cares? I mean, it almost saddens me if you're so focused on your past days being your best days. God, what a sad life you must be living right now. If your best days are your past days. So if you will this morning, I just want to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes for a moment. And just ask you to be honest and really, no one's looking. I'm not going to ask you to do anything. I'm not going to sneak up on you and hit you with a Bible. That'd be weird. I guess so. But as you go in this time of reverence, I invite you to have an honest conversation with God. Whether you believe or don't believe, whether you have your opinions or whatever they are, would you take a minute to have an honest conversation with God? About what's next in my life? What's next? Even if you're someone who really doesn't care, just try. So Father, as we enter into a holy moment, God, I thank you that you're a God who's alive, that you're a God who speaks to us in so many different ways. And God, this morning we may be here, Lord, and we're staring at a hurdle we put in front of our lives, or a hurdle someone else has put in front of our life. And we don't know what to do, God. Speak to us, Father. There may be some here this morning, Father, who feel like they're at a crossroads. They don't know which way to go. Maybe going deeper in their relationship, Father, with you is that crossroad. They don't know if they're really ready to walk away from the friend scene or the social scene that they know they shouldn't be in, that they know is not doing anything for them. And that decision seems like a hurdle, Father. Speak to them, Father. Or maybe it's some of us here, Lord, who are sick and tired of being sick and tired. And we don't know what's next. Feel like we can't catch a break. God, remind them that you're with them. You haven't forsaken them. God, for all of us, at such a time as this, Father, you see robberies, and theft, rape, molestation, sex trafficking, brokenness in our city. God, I'm left asking the question, what's next, God? What next scandal is going to come out? What next life is going to be taken? Father, then I'm reminded by just a simple phrase you spoke to me yesterday. What are you going to do about it? God, you've equipped us to win the city. We are plan A. There is no plan B. So God, maybe for us, what's next for some of us, Lord, is going deeper in that journey. Is having a conversation with someone and inviting them to Easter, inviting them into our small group, or inviting them to coffee or lunch or dinner, Father. Maybe that's what's next for some of us, is to start taking life seriously, winning souls for Jesus. God, wherever we're at this morning, Father, may we be reminded with an encounter of truth. Jesus changes everything. And Lord, right now, whether we come off to the side to pray or stay in our seats, Father, we just want to take a few moments now to hear from you. God, I'm reminded of the Father in Luke 15, while the Son was a far way off, how he was making small steps towards the Father. The Father ran out. And Father, you're not asking us to do a bunch of crazy things, long list of get rights. You're just asking us to take a step. Because you're a good Father who loves us, you run after us. Lord, whatever that looks like this morning, I pray for us to take that step over that hurdle into the arms of a loving Father waiting on the other side. Enables and equips us to overcome. So Lord, as we just take a few moments, God, have your way. In Jesus' name. Okay.
To you are. confess you. I just want to bask in your glory right now. Speak softly to us. And let us just listen to your words. As you tell us, you're pleased. Maybe we might not have always made the best choices, but you took an eternity molding us together, creating us with a perfect plan. You can point to every single person in this room with the purest of love and say, I created you and I love you. I desire you. Maybe someone this morning really needs to hear that. The creator of the entire universe. The master, the mighty warrior, our great savior, intimately and deeply desires us. And we thank you for that. We thank you for being good to us, Father. Again, even when we might not be the best, you call us child. Say to anyone, if you need a hand, if you just need a good word, you can find one of us on the team here. We'd be glad to talk with you. We're a city for the church and for the people. And God is a God for us. We didn't make him up. He's not something of our own design. That would be a terrible God if I had a drawing board. Thankfully, we get something better. So let's sing to our good Father and let him know how much we appreciate it. You're a good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am.
I've been there, man. And I'm not going to ask you to move. I don't want to drag this out. I'm not trying to play off your emotion. But because I care for you. With every head bowed, every eyes closed, if you say, hey, this morning, Pastor, I need you to pray for me. Would you just raise your hand where you're seated right now? Just raise your hand where you're standing right now. Say, I need prayer. I need prayer. Hands are going up. Hands are going up. The Lord press your burden on me. Let me just pray for you right now. God, you know what's on our hearts. God, you know everyone's story in this room. And God, right now, Father, the enemy is just leaning into us with lies. Don't move. Don't be honest. You can still fix this. You can still get over this. You don't need God. And Father, when lies speak louder than truth, remind us that we belong to you. We are sons and we are daughters of a King and of a good Father. And God, I pray victory, I pray peace, I pray overcoming obstacles over these individuals' lives, God. Freedom, Father. Lord, you show us in Scripture where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. The Holy Spirit, you're welcome here. I feel you in this place, God. So in this moment, God, I just pray that you would do whatever you need to do, that we would yield. We would decrease so you could increase. And we read in John 3:30. And God, as we leave this place, may we leave a simple phrase on our hearts and our minds. God, what's next? We're not looking at the past anymore. We're not walking in defeat anymore. We're asking God, what's next? What's your will for my life? I'm ready. To make one more step forward, God. To put my faith back on you and not a body of believers or a church. None of those things are bad, God. Our focus has to stay on you. Lord, may we leave this place energized and refreshed and ready to enter into the Holy Week, God. Remembering what Friday symbolizes Jesus' crucifixion. God, Sunday, expecting for Easter for you to show out. Lord, we love you. Be with us as we live this place. In Jesus' name. Thank you so much for spending your Sunday here with us. You are this good. Sure.
Yeah. Yeah, putting everything in there.
Makes sense.
I have a
crap, I didn't stop recording.
I have to go 2 days without the drop.